This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The Grey Cloak by Harold MacGrath. Chapter 1, The Man in the Cloak. A man enveloped in a handsome grey cloak groped through a dark alley which led into the fashionable district of the Rue de Bevisy. From time to time he paused, with a hand to his ear as if listening. Satisfied that the alley was deserted save for his own presence, he would proceed, hugging the walls. The cobbles were icy, and scarce a moment passed in which he did not have to struggle to maintain his balance. The door of a low tavern opened suddenly, sending a golden shaft of light across the glistening pavement and casting a brilliant patch on the opposite wall. With the light came sounds of laughter and quarreling and ringing glasses. The man laid his hand on his sword, swore softly, and stepped back out of the blinding glare. The flash of light revealed a mask which left visible only the lower half of his face. Men wearing masks were frequently subjected to embarrassing questions, and this man was determined that no one should question him tonight. He waited, hiding in the shadow. Half a dozen guardsmen and musketeers reeled out. The host reviled them for a pack of rogues. They cursed him, laughing, and went on to be swallowed up in the darkness beyond. The tavern door closed, and once more the alley was hued with melting grays and purples. The man in the cloak examined the strings of his mask, tilted his hat still farther down over his eyes, and tested the looseness of his sword. "The drunken fools," he muttered, continuing. "Well for them they came not this way." When he entered the Rue de Bevisy, he stopped, searched up and down the thoroughfare. Far away to his right he saw wavering torches, but these receded and abruptly vanished round a corner of the Rue des Fosses Saint-Germain-l'Auxerrois. He was alone. 100 yards to his left, on the opposite side of the street, stood a gloomy but magnificent hotel, one of the few in this quarter that was surrounded by a walled court. The hotel was dark. So far as the man in the grey cloak could see, not a light filled any window. There were two gates. Toward the smaller of the two, the man cautiously directed his steps. He tried the latch. The gate opened noiselessly, signifying frequent use. So far, so good. An indecisive moment passed, as though the man were nerving himself for an ordeal of courage and cunning. With a gesture resigning himself to whatever might befall, he entered the court, careful to observe that the way out was no more intricate than the way in. Now for the ladder. If that is missing its horse and away to Spain, or feel the edge of Monsieur Cabochet. Will the lackey be true? False or true, I must trust him. Bernouin would sell Mazarin for 20 louis, and that is what I have paid. Monsieur le Comte's lackey. It will be a clever trick. Mazarin will pay as many as 10,000 livres for that paper. That fat fool of a Gaston to conspire at his age. Bah, what a muddled ass I was, in faith. I to sign my name in writing to a cabal. Only the devil knows what yonder old fool will do with the paper. Let him become frightened, let that painted playwoman coddle him, and it's the block for us all save Gaston and Condé and Beaufort. Ah, madam, madam, loveliest in all France, 'twas your beautiful eyes. For the joy of looking into them, I have soiled a fresh quill, tumbled into a pit, played the fool. And a silver crown against a golden louis, you know nothing about politics or intrigue, nor that that old fool of a husband is making a decoy of your beauty. But my head cleared this morning. That paper must be mine. First, because it is a guarantee for my head, and second, because it is likely to fatten my purse. It will be simple to erase my name and substitute another's. And this cloak. My faith, it is a stroke. To the devil with Gaston and Condé and Beaufort, their ambitions are nothing to me since my head is everything. He tiptoed across the stone flags. Faith, this is a delicate operation, and the paper may be hidden elsewhere into the bargain. We venture, we lose, or we win, only this is somewhat out of my line of work. Self-preservation is not theft, let us ease our conscience with this sophism. Ha, the latter. Those 20 louis were well spent. This is droll, Goodheart. An onlooker would swear that this is an assignation. Eh well, Romeo was a sickly lover, and lopped about like a rose in a windstorm. Mercutio was the man. He had gained the side of the hotel. From a window above came a faint yellow haze, such as might radiate from a single candle. This was the signal that all was clear. The man tested the ladder, which was of rope, and it withstood his weight. Very gently, he began to climb, stopping every 3 or 4 rounds and listening. The only noise came from the armory, where a parcel of mercenaries were moving about. Up, up, round by round, till his fingers touched the damp cold stone of the window ledge, the man raised himself, leaned toward the left, and glanced obliquely into the room. It was deserted. A candle burned in a small alcove. The man drew himself quickly into the room, which was a kind of gallery facing the grand staircase. A sound coming from the hall below caused the intruder to slip behind a curtain. A lackey was unbarring the door. The man in the gallery wondered why. "My very nerves have ears," he murmured. "If I were sure, to pay Madame a visit while she sleeps and dreams." His hand grew tense around the hilt of his sword. "No, let us play Iago rather than Tarquinius, let ambition rather than love strike the keynote. Greed was not born to wait. As yet I have robbed no man save at cards, and as every noble cheats when he can, I can do no less. Neither have I struck a man in the back. And I like not this night's business." On the cold and silent night came 10 solemn strokes from the clock of Saint-Germain-l'Auxerrois. Then all was still again. The man came from behind the curtain, his naked sword flashing evilly in the flickering light. He took up the candle, and walked coolly down the wide corridor. The sureness of his step could have originated only in the perfect knowledge of the topography of the hotel. He paused before a door, his ear to the keyhole. "She sleeps, and the wolf prowls without the door." He mused over the wayward path by which he had come into the presence of this woman, who slept tranquilly beyond these panels of oak. He felt a glow on his cheeks, a quickening of his pulse. To what lengths would he not go for her sake? Sure of winning her love, yes, he would become great, rise purified from the slough of loose living. He had never killed a man dishonorably. He had won his duels by strength and dexterity alone. He had never taken an advantage of a weakling, for many a man had insulted him and still walked the earth, suffering only the slight inconvenience of a bandaged arm or a tender cheek and a fortnight or so in bed. Condé had once said of him that there was not a more courageous man in France, but he could not escape recalling Condé's afterthought, that drink and reckless temper had kept him where he was. There was in him a vein of madness which often burst forth in a blind fury. It had come upon him in battle, and he had awakened many a time to learn that he had been the hero of an exploit. He was not a boaster, he was not a broken soldier. He was a man whose violent temper had strewn his path with failures. In love. Silently, he mocked himself. In love, he, the tried veteran of 100 inconstancies. He smiled grimly beneath his mask. He passed on stealthily, till he reached a door guarded by 2 effigies of Francis I. His sword accidentally touched the metal, and the soft clang tingled every nerve in his body. He waited. Far away, a horse was galloping over the pavement. He tried the door, and it gave way to his pressure. He stood in the library of the master of the hotel. In this very room, while his brain was filled with the fumes of wine and passion, he had scribbled his name upon crackling parchment on which were such names as Gaston d'Orléans, Condé, Beaufort, de Longueville, de Retz. Fool! Grinning from the high shelves were the Greek masks, comedy and tragedy. The light from the candle gave a sickly human tint to the marble. He closed the door. "Now for the drawer which holds my head, of love anon." He knelt, placing the candle on the book ledge. Along the bottom of the shelves ran a series of drawers. These he opened without sound, searching for secret bottoms. Drawer after drawer yawned into his face, and his heart sank. What he sought was not to be found. The last drawer would not open. With infinite care and toil, he succeeded in prying the lock with the point of his sword, and his spirits rose. The papers in this drawer were of no use to anyone but the owner. The man in the gray cloak cursed under his breath, and a thrill of rage ran through him. He was about to give up in despair when he saw a small knob protruding from the back panel of the drawer. Eagerly he touched the knob, and a little drawer slid forth. "Mine." With trembling fingers, he unfolded the parchment. He held it close to the candle and scanned each signature. There was his own, somewhat shaky, but nevertheless his own. He brushed his eyes, as if cobwebs of doubt had suddenly gathered there. Her signature. Hers. Roses of Venus, she is mine, mine. He pressed his lips to the ink and line. Fortune indeed favored him, or was it the devil? Hers. She was his, here was a sword to bend that proud neck. 10,000 livres. There was more than that by 100 times. Passion first or avarice, love or greed? He would decide that question later. He slipped the paper into the pocket of the cloak. Curiosity drew him toward the drawer again. There was an old commission in the Musketeers, signed by Louis XIII, letters from Madame de Longueville, an unsigned lettre de cachet, an accounting of the revenues of the various chateaus, and a long envelope yellow with age. He picked it out of the drawer and blew away the dust. He read the almost faded address, and his jaw fell. To Monsieur le Marquis de Perigny, to be delivered into his hands at my death. He was not conscious how long a time he stared at that address. Age had unsealed the envelope, and the man in the gray cloak drew out the contents. It was in Latin, and with some difficulty he translated it. So rapt was he over what he read, so nearly in a dream he knelt there, that neither the sound of a horse entering the court, nor the stir of activity in the armory held forth a menace. "Good God, what a revenge," he murmured. "What a revenge." Twice, three times, and yet again he drank of the secret. That he of all men should make this discovery. His danger became as nothing, he forgot even the object of his thieving visit. "Well, monsieur," said a cold, dry voice from the threshold. The man in the gray cloak leapt to his feet, thrusting the letter into the pocket along with the cabal. His long rapier snarled from its scabbard just in time. The two blades hung in mid-air. "Nicely caught," said the cold, dry voice again. "What have you to say?" "It is hanging, monsieur, hanging by the neck." The speaker was a man of 60, white of hair, but wiry and active. "Ha, in a mask, eh? That looks bad for you. You are not a common thief, then?" "That was a good stroke, but not quite high enough." "Well?" "Stand aside, monsieur le comte," said the man in the cloak. His tones were steady. All his fright was gone. The steel slithered and ground. "You know me, eh?" said the old man banteringly. His blade ripped a hole in the cloak. "You have a voice that sounds strangely familiar to my ears. Your ears will soon be dull and cold if you do not let me pass." Was it gold or jewels? Jesus! The old man's gaze, roving a hair's breadth, saw the yawning drawers. "That paper, monsieur, or you shall never leave this place alive." "Hello? Help, men." "To me, Gregoire." "Help, captain." "Madame shall become a widow," said the man in the mask. Back he pressed the old man back into the corridor toward the stairs. They could scarce see each other, and it was by instinct alone that thrust was met by parry. Up the rear staircase came a dozen mercenaries, bearing torches. The glare smote the master in the eyes and partly dazzled him. He fought valiantly, but he was forced to give way. A chance thrust, however, severed the cords of his opponent's mask. "You?" There was a gurgling sound, a coughing, and the elder sank to his knees, rolled upon his side, and became still. The man in the gray cloak, holding the mask to his face, rushed down the grand staircase, sweeping aside all those who barred his path. He seemed possessed with strength and courage Homeric, odds were nothing. With a backhand swing of his arm he broke one head, he smashed a face with the pommel, caught another by the throat and flung him headlong. In a moment, he was out of the door. Down the steps he dashed, through the gate, thence into the street, a mob yelling at his heels. The light from the torches splashed him. A sharp gust of wind nearly tore the mask from his fingers. As he caught it, he ran full into a priest. Out of the way, then, curse you. Before the astonished priest, who was a young man, could rise from the pavement where the impact had sent him sprawling, the assailant had disappeared in the alley. He gained the door of the low tavern, flung it open, pushed by everyone, upsetting several, all the while the bloody rapier in one hand and the mask held in place by the other. The astonished inmates of the tavern saw him leap like a huge bird and vanish through one of the windows, carrying the sash with him. But a nail caught the grey cloak, and it fluttered back to the floor. Scarce a moment had passed when the pursuers crowded in. When questioned, the stupefied host could only point toward the splintered window frame. Through this the men scrambled, and presently their yells died away in the distance. A young man of ruddy countenance, his body clothed in the garments of a gentleman's lackey, stooped and gathered up the cloak. "Holy Virgin," he murmured, his eyes bulging, "there cannot be two cloaks like this in Paris, it's the very same." He crushed it under his arm, and in the general confusion gained the alley, took to his legs, and became a moving black shadow in the grey. He made off toward the Seine. Meanwhile, terror stalked in the corridors of the hotel. Lights flashed from window to window. The court was full of servants and mercenaries. For the master lay dead in the corridor above. A beautiful young woman, dressed in her night robes, her feet in slippers, hair disordered and her eyes fixed with horror, gazed down at the lifeless shape. The stupor of sleep still held her in its dulling grasp. She could not fully comprehend the tragedy. Her ladies wailed about her, but she heeded them not. It was only when the captain of the military household approached her that she became fully aroused. She pressed her hand against her madly beating heart. Illustration: she pressed her hands against her madly beating heart. "Who did this?" she asked. "A man in a mask, madam," replied the captain, kneeling. He gently loosed the sword from the stiffening fingers. The master of 25 years was gone. "In a mask?" "Yes, madam." "And the motive?" "Not robbery, since nothing is disturbed about the hotel save in Monsieur's library. The drawers have all been pulled out." With a sharp cry, she crossed the corridor and entered the library. The open drawers spoke dumbly but surely. "Gone," she whispered. "We are all lost. He was fortunate in dying." Terror and fright vanished from her face and her eyes, leaving the one impassive and the other cold. She returned to the body, and the look she cast on it was without pity or regret. Alive, she had detested him; dead, she could gaze on him with indifference. He had died, leaving her the legacy of the headsman's axe. And his playwoman, would she weep or laugh? She was free. It came quickly and penetrated like a dry wine. She was free. 4 odious years might easily be forgiven, if not forgotten. "Take him to his room," she said softly. After all, he had died gallantly. Soon one of the pursuers returned. He was led into the presence of his mistress. "Have they found him?" "No, madam. He disappeared as completely as if the ground had swallowed him. All that can be added is that he wore a grey cloak." "A grey cloak, did you say?" Her hand flew to her throat and her eyes grew wild again. "A grey cloak?" "Yes, madam, a grey cloak with a square velvet collar." "Ah," said the captain with a singular smile. He glanced obliquely at madam. But madam lurched forward into the arms of one of her waiting women. She had fainted. End of the chapter. Chapter 2: The Toilet of the Chevalier du Cevennes. The Chevalier du Cevennes occupied the apartment on the first floor of the Hotel of the Silver Candlestick in the Rue Guénégaud. The apartment consisted of 3 rooms. In all Paris, there was not to be found the like of them. They were not only elegant, they were simple, for true elegance is always closely allied to simplicity. Persian rugs covered the floors, rugs upon which many a true believer had knelt in evening prayer. Moorish tapestries hung from the walls, making a fine and mellow background for the various pieces of ancient and modern armor. Here and there were Greek marbles and Italian vases, and several spirited paintings filled the gaps left between one tapestry and another. Sometimes the Chevalier entertained his noble friends, young and old, in these rooms, and the famous kitchens of Madame Boisjoli, the landlady of the Candlestick, supplied the delicacies of his tables. Ordinarily the Chevalier dined in the cheery assembly room below, for like all true gourmands of refinement, he believed that there is as much appetite in a man's ears and eyes as in his stomach, and to feed the latter properly there must be light, a coming and going of old and new faces, the rumor of voices, the jest, and the snatch of song. At this moment the Chevalier was taking a bath, and was splashing about in the warm water, laughing with the joyous heart of a boy. With the mild steam rose the vague perfume of violets. Brave as a krillin though he was, fearless as a bussy, the Chevalier was something of a fop, not the mincing, lisping fop, but one who loved physical cleanliness, who took pride in the whiteness of his skin, the clarity of his eyes. There had been summer nights in the brilliant gardens of La Place Royale, when he had been pointed out as one of the handsomest youths in Paris. Ah, those summer nights, the cymbals and trumpets of Les Beaux Mousquetaires, the display of feathers and lace, unwrought pearls and ropes of precious stones, the lisping and murmuring of silks, the variety of colors, the fair dames with their hoods, their masks, their elaborate coiffures, the crowds in the balconies. All the celebrities of court might be seen promenading the place, and to be identified as one above many was a plume such as all Mazarin's gold could not buy. "My faith, but this has been a day," he murmured, gazing wistfully at his ragged nails. "Till I entered this tub there was nothing but lead in my veins, nothing but marble on my bones. Look at those boots, Breton lad, a spur gone, the soles loose, the heels cracked. And that cloak. The mud on the skirts is a week old. And that scabbard was new when I left Paris. When I came up I looked like a swashbuckler in one of Scuderi's plays. I let no one see me. Indeed, I doubt if any would have recognized me. But a man cannot ride from Rome to Paris, after having ridden from Paris to Rome, changing neither his clothes nor his horse, without losing some particle of his fastidiousness, and, body of Bacchus, I have lost no small particle of mine." "Ah, Monsieur Paul," said the lackey, hiding the cast-off clothing in the closet, "I am that glad to see you safe and sound again. Your own face is welcome, lad. What weather I have seen," wringing his mustache and royal. "And heaven forfend that another such ride falls my lot." He smiled at the ruddy heap in the fireplace. What a ride indeed. For nearly 2 weeks he had ridden over hills and mountains, through valleys and gorges, access deep and shallow streams, sometimes beneath the sun, sometimes beneath the moon or the stars, sometimes beneath the flying black canopies of midnight storms, always and ever toward Paris. He had been harried by straggling Spaniards, he had drawn his sword 3 times in unavoidable tavern brawls, he had been robbed of his purse, he had even pawned his signet ring for a night's lodging, all because Mazarin had asked a question which only the Pope could answer. Paris at last, Paris the fanciful, the illogical, the changeable, the wholly delightful Paris. He knew his Paris well, did the Chevalier. He had been absent 30 days, and on the way in from Fontainebleau, where he had spent the preceding night at the expense of his signet ring, he had wondered what changes had taken place among the exiles and favorites during this time. What if the Grande Mademoiselle again headed that comic revolution, the Fronde, as in the old days when she climbed the walls at Orléans and assumed command against the forces of the king? What if Monsieur de Retz issued orders from the Palais Royal, using the same pen with which Mazarin had demanded his resignation as Archbishop of Paris? In fact, what if Madame de Longueville, aided by the middle class, had once more taken up quarters in the Hôtel de Ville? Oh, so many things happened in Paris in 30 days that the Chevalier would not have been surprised to learn that the boy Louis had declared to govern his kingdom without the assistance of ministers, priests, and old women. Ah, that Fronde! Those had been gallant days, laughable, it is true, but everyone seemed to be able to pluck a feather from the golden goose of fortune. He was 18 then, and had followed the royal exodus to Germain. The Chevalier sighed as he continued to absorb the genial heat of the water. The captain at the Port Saint Antoine had told him that the Grande Mademoiselle was still in exile at Blois, writing lampoons against the court, and particularly against Mazarin, that de Retz was biting his nails, full of rage and impotence against those fetters which banishment casts around men of action, that Madame de Longueville was conducting a love intrigue in Normandy, and that Louis had to borrow or beg his pocket money. Strange as it seemed to the Chevalier, Paris was unchanged. But what warmed the Chevalier's heart, even as the water warmed his body, was the thought of that adorable mystery, that tantalizing, haunting mystery, the woman unknown. This very room was made precious by the fact that its air had once embraced her with a familiarity such as he had never dared assume. What a night that had been! She had come, masked, she had dined, at his protestations of love she had laughed, as one laughs who hears a droll story, and in the attempt to put his arm around her waist, the cold light flashing from her half-hidden eyes had stilled and abashed him. Why did she hold him, yet repel? What was her object? Was she some princess who had been hidden away during her girlhood, to appear only when the bud opened into womanhood, rich, glorious, and warm? Like a sunbeam, like a shadow, she flitted through the corridors and galleries of the Louvre and the Palais Royal, and whenever he had sought to point her out to someone to discover her name, lo, she was gone. Tormenting mystery. Ah, that soft lisp of hers, those enchanting caprices, those amazing extravagances of fancy, that wit which possessed the sparkle of white chamberlain. He would never forget that summer night when, dressed as a boy, she had gone with him swashbuckling along the quays. And for all these meetings, for all her supplicating or imperious notes, what had been his reward? To kiss her hand when she came, to kiss her hand when she went, and all the while her lips burned like a cardinal poppy, and her eyes lured like those phantom lakes of the desert. True, he had often kissed her perfumed tresses without her knowledge, but what was that? Why had he never taken by force that which entreaty did not win? Love. Man never uses force where he loves. When would the day come when the hedge of mystery enclosing her would be leveled? Love you, monsieur, she had said. Ah, well, in a way. The Chevalier smiled. Yes, it was fine to be young and rich and in love. He recalled their first meeting. He had been placed on guard at the entrance to the Grand Gallery at the Palais Royal, where Mazarin was giving a masque. Presently, a slender, elegant youth in the garb of a grey musketeer approached. Your name, monsieur, if you please, he said, scanning the list of invited guests. I am one of those who pass without the interrogatory. The voice was hoarse, affectedly so, and this roused the Chevalier's suspicions. I cannot believe that, he laughed, since Monsieur le Duc, His Majesty's brother, was good enough to permit me to question him. He leaned against the wall, smiling and twisting his mustache. What a charming musketeer! What, haughtily, you parley with me? A gauntleted hand flew to a jeweled hilt. Monsieur will not be so rude. Mockingly. Monsieur, with a stamp of the foot, a charming foot. Monsieur, he mimicked, also stamping a foot which, though shapely, was scarce charming. Then through the curtain of the mask there came a low, rollicking laugh. The hand fell away from the sword hilt, and a grey gauntlet slipped to the floor, discovering a hand as dazzling white and begemmed as that on which Anne of Austria prided herself. Death of my life, said a voice as soft and musical as the vibration of a bell, you make an admirable Cerberus. My gauntlet. The sweep of the hand fascinated him. Are your ears like the sailors of Ulysses, filled with wax? I am asking you to pick up my gauntlet. As he stooped to obey the command, a laugh sounded behind him, and he knew that he had been tricked. The little musketeer had vanished. For a moment, he was disturbed. In vain he searched the gauntlet for some distinguishing sign. But as reason told him that no harm could possibly come from the prank, his fears subsided, and he laughed. On being relieved from duty, later he sought her to return the gauntlet. She was talking to Mademoiselle de Longueville. As she saw the Chevalier, she moved away. The Chevalier, determined on seeing the adventure to its end, followed her deliberately. She sat in a window seat. Without ceremony, he sat down beside her. Monsieur, he said, smiling, and he was very handsome when he smiled, permit me to return this gauntlet. She folded her arms, and this movement of her shoulders told him that she was laughing silently. Are you Madame or Mademoiselle? He asked eagerly. She raised her mask for an instant, and his subjugation was complete. The conversation which ensued was so piquant and charming that thereafter whatever warmth the gauntlet knew was gathered not from her hand, but from the Chevalier's heart. The growing chill in the water brought the Chevalier out of his.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.